the most important question I want to get is, who wrote the initiative? Who drafted the...
Well, let me talk about it. Let's you and I talk about it a little bit, so I can say what you want me to say.
Yeah.
I and a guy that worked for me, Bob Ficker, who now lives in Portland, we went to a meeting. Let me step back. I went to a meeting, and Victor said he thought the only thing was an initiative, that we could win that. And people were volunteering to do things like raise money and do things. And Victor said, well, first we got to have the initiative. We got to have some law, some legislation.
No.
So I volunteered to go, I'm an attorney, but to go do some research. He said he thought he had heard that New Orleans had done something like that. So I explained legal research to Bob, a bright guy. He's just instant.
Bob who?
Bob Ficker, this guy that
okay.
worked with him. I explained what legal research was. And we went over to the Keith County Library, and we started digging around. And we found the New Orleans law. And then we found another one.
For the Vieux Carré Commission.
Yeah, Vieux Carré, And then we found one from... I cannot remember whether it was another part of the South. It rings a bell. It was somewhere up in the North. But anyway, we found two laws. We spent about, it's so long ago, 2-3 days reading it all and melding it and putting together what we thought were the best parts. But we took everything back to Victor. There was another meeting. I think Jerry Thorne was at it. He's an attorney. Victor said, great. He said, I think at the first meeting, he said, all I need is a law. I can put the boundary descriptions in, but I don't know what the law should say. He said, I know what I want to do. And I know what area I want to put in it, but I don't, it's got to obviously be, 3 or 4 pages of ordinance. So that we gave him that. Bob and I melded it all together and wrote it up and gave it to Victor. And I was busy. I couldn't be at a meeting where he took it. And everyone thought it was great. And I was working for Wes at the time, so I had to be... Victor knew that. I told him when I volunteered, I said, you can't talk about me being part of this or I'll be out of a job. Because Wes, I don't know if you remember, at that time he was pushing the urban renewal.
Well, everybody thought that was a sensible, progressive thing to do. It was not a dishonorable position.
No. It wasn't a bad position, but it didn't have the vision that Victor had. So anyway, we drafted. He took it. He obviously added to it the boundaries. I remember many years later, not many, but... 10 years later, him saying, I just wish I'd have made the boundaries bigger. I mean, he didn't go up to first, he didn't go all the way up to first.
Yeah.
He just said, I thought I'd saved enough. Because he saved all the old buildings. That's what he did. And he just was sorry he hadn't made it bigger. But then, that's all we did with it. I mean, that's the most, that was our extent.
What, were you employed by the city then? Or?
Yeah, I was running DHR.
Oh.
Well, let's see, 78? No, when was
68.
It?
68.
I mean, 68, 69.
Yeah.
Might have been called Office of Human Resources.
Yeah, because you had been with the university's research.
I was with the government, research and service. Then I went with OEO down in San Francisco. Then came back up here and worked for the local community action agency.
Okay.
And then Ed Devine got me into city work with kids and stuff. Excuse me. And then Wes came in, right?
Yeah.
He got an extra... He came in 69. He got an extra year because he switched to the strong year.
This is all fun for me because I left in April of 69.
Okay.
Went back east and it was gone 10 years. So.
Yeah, I remember. I remember you told me that part of your life. Anyway.
Hi. I got another general question that's important.
Yeah. That's what happened. You tell me what you remember. And that's too long a story to
No, that's good, because I have some other interviews on tape there. Jerry Thon, particularly, indicated that. And also Ken Pritchard, who collects slides around, recalls, but he couldn't recall the name. The other general question I have is, what is your first experience of the market? When did you first see it? When did you first realize this place is special?
It must go back to, you know, when we first came here in 58. That's 40 years ago, Paul. I mean, I don't have a recollection other than all the stalls and all the fish and all the no T-shirts. I mean, it was all produce and food and meat and fish. Some knickknacks. You remember the woman that used to be somewhere that sold kind of little trinkets, like she made handmade little.
Well, there was a Birdie Richardson that used to sell stuff made out of nuts and seeds and necklaces and
necklaces.
And she was from Kansas City, or
well, that was considered, you know, that was non-food. I mean, that was way out, way back then.
Yeah.
I mean, not way out, but I mean, that was unusual to see that among all the food and all the plants. Way back then, again, very little flowers. I mean, there were some. People had flowers. I mean, people had flowers when they bloomed, but nowadays it just seems like the place is.
Yeah.
And that's not bad. I'm not saying that's bad, but a hell of a lot of flowers.
Yeah. Well, my favorite story on that is the produce. Farmer selling flowers, and she said, "I used to sell carrots, and I'd sell them to people three bunches for a dollar, and they'd grumble. And they're good carrots. And now I sell them flowers. I charge them $5, and they smile and they're happy.
Say, gee,
I'd rather
that's
sell
a good
flowers.
Price.
Yeah.
So okay.
Oh, that's good.
Those guys, but I just wanted to make sure Victor understood." What we were, you know, that we had melded the two things together, and that because they were slightly different.
What's interesting is at that time the whole National Historic Preservation movement was just beginning.
And those were we could only find two other cities.
And Victor's addition to it, I mean, the research you gave him, he obviously put in there the use approval, the control over use within the buildings, and that doesn't occur anymore.
No, I think, well, he told us some of the things he wrote.
Yeah.
So that's what we wrote.
Yeah.
We wrote, that's why I say we melded not only the two we found, but what he wanted also. So.
Yeah.
Anyway. God, it's a long time ago.
We were thinking about those picket lines we had out in front of City Hall. Remember Phyllis was, I'm trying to remember if she was waffling on that thing, and then finally, there was kind of like enough demonstration, public demonstration, where I think she just cut and took the side of the citizens against the big renovation. Remember, Wes was still supporting
They were supporting
the
renewal.
Urban renewal. Yeah, and I think Phil is that there was just enough public demonstration. She just cleared. She finally buckled and said, "That's it. Yeah, I'm pulling out. I can't support this anymore. The people don't want it."
So it was good times. Now you're doing this for libraries or for
I guess my questions are just.
You want me to send this in or just fill it out?
Or if you know someone that we don't.
Oh,
have
I see.
Contact with.
For other people.
Yeah, because mostly we're having trouble with addresses and phone numbers.
Sure.
People move on and things like that.
Sure.
Just put that in your pocket and
yeah, I'll do that.
On it. A question I ask a lot of people, just to get them warmed up, can you remember the first experiences you had at the market and why it became special for you?
When I was about 6 years old, my mother used to bring me in from Foster, where I lived, which is about 10 miles south of town.
Yeah.
And we would come in on the interurban. Uh-huh. And the interurban Suburban was the train that went from Tacoma to Seattle.
Yeah.
And there was also one, I guess, from Everett to Seattle. But we lived out about 10 miles south of town in a place called Foster. Actually, it was Mortimer Heights. And we went down to the Mortimer Junction and got the interurban and came in. And the interurban stopped on Occidental Street, just south of Yesler.
Okay.
Came to there and stopped. And then we would get on the streetcar and go up to the market. It was probably 1924 or something like that.
Right up First Avenue.
Right up First Avenue.
Yeah.
And, I might have been second or third. And went to the market. And she would go to the market and do her shopping, maybe once a week or something like that. And she would leave me at the taffy pulling machine. There was a taffy pulling machine inside of four glass sides, and this machine, it was something like that. It would twist and they'd pull up taffy and keep going and make taffy. And I would have my face glued to the glass and watch that thing. Of course, if I got tired of that, I would go over to the donut making machine. And there was a machine that pulled dough up out and punched a hole in it. It rolled on the tube or some thing, I don't remember how, and would drop down into the boiling oil and make a donut.
Mm-hmm.
So between those two machines, I was vastly entertained. And she would come back and get me. We'd go back down to Occidental Street, catch the interurban, and go home. So that's where I first met the market.
Uh-huh.
Later, I don't know, but you know, it's funny. Victor tells me that, or told me, that I introduced him to the market.
Mm-hmm.
Which I don't remember doing, but I suppose that's maybe true, but I don't remember it. Anyway, years later, after I became an architect, I used to, we had an office over on Fifth Avenue between Lenora and Blanchard,
mm-hmm.
or no, between Virginia and Lenora, and we would go over to the market for lunch. We were young architects and flat broke all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd go to the market where we could eat cheap, and
mm-hmm.
We learned about this Bolivian restaurant, and this is before the Friends of the Market was ever formed,
mm-hmm.
and we started a group called the Cracker Barrel Club. We went to the Bolivian restaurant because it was only four or five seats at a counter. He couldn't accommodate all of us. He'd put down a produce box outside the door. And
mm-hmm.
we would sit around that, and he would service his Bolivian food out there.
Okay.
He's the guy that now has the Copacabana.
His daughter-in-law, or his daughter.
Oh, yeah. I suppose maybe he's gone.
Yeah.
All my friends are dropping off. Anyway, that's when I first, I always went to the market, but I don't remember much between my mother's taking me there as a child and later.
Mm-hmm.
But then years later, when the market was threatened, then Vic and I and Elizabeth Tanner and some others, her name Anderson.
Julie Anderson. Mm-hmm.
And others, we started the Friends of the Market and then carried on the campaign, and so that was it.
Mm-hmm. Were you active in Allied Arts before the Friends of the Market began?
No, I was not active in I was actually at the birth of the, I attended at the birth of Allied Arts when John Dentley decided, and Jack Wright decided to get it started, or to start a group with that name. But I wasn't active, and I actually didn't join until I was asked to be president of it in 1970, I think it was. And they said, well, you better join first. So that's when I became active in Allied Arts.
Mm-hmm. But you were active with Friends of the Market from its start in 1964.
Yeah, from the start of that until through the campaign, and then we did some work down there, and I've gone there ever since, still go there.
Did you redo the Triangle Building?
Yes, we did the Triangle Building. We did the Corner Market. Well, actually it was Carl Rekovics really did that. He was a partner of mine for many years, but he did that when he took a leave of absence and worked at the market
mm-hmm.
as an employee of the city at that time, I guess. And then we did the Sanitary Market, which my partner Skip Norton did, and the one just north of that, at the corner of First and Pine.
Post Alley Market.
Yeah, Post Alley.
Just north of the corner market.
Yeah.
So those are the projects we did.
Yeah. Well,
the
only one
I participated in was the Triangle Market.
I live in the Triangle building.
Oh, you
and,
do?
Yeah, and I want to complain that I've got a little slope in my floor.
Bookcases
have to be held against the wall. But now I know where to write this down.
Oh, that's a nice. I'm really proud of that building. I think Skip deserves more credit than I do on that. But I've always been proud of it. You know, there's a funny story about that. While that was under construction, I remember going over there after work one day to look at how it was coming along and noticing that it was on a single post steel pipe at the corner, which, you know, kind of a sharp corner the way it's a triangle. And I thought, gee, that sort of looks unstable. I don't have it braced very well. And I thought, God, what if there was a earthquake tonight? That thing would really go tumbling down. We'd lose it forever. I called when I got home that evening, I called the contractor. It was a black man, I think, that was the contractor. And I suggested, you know, you really ought to brace that thing because it's dangerous the way it is. If there were a strong wind or an earthquake, it'd go down. So he promised to go down after dinner and brace it, which he did. And you know, that night there was a small earthquake, about a 3 Richter or something, and it was saved. I still like the building. It's a nice building, lovely apartment,
yeah,
so I think you're lucky to be in it.
I feel the
view.
Same thing, too.
It's a wonderful space.
Yeah.
We were in it last night, and then beautiful view down to the street.
Back in the 60s, as the Friends were working towards avoiding the urbanization of the market, did you hold offices with the Friends of the Market, or were you...
What do you mean, did I hold offices?
I mean, did it have offices, presidents, secretaries, and things like
that?
No,
we didn't. Victor was the de facto chairman. He was a professor, and he had time to monkey with it and devote time to it. I was an architect trying desperately to make a living. Although that time the living was pretty good. We were very busy in the late 60s. But just before the Boeing crash, you know, the Boeing crash was about 69 or 70.
You were designing college dormitories that I ended up living in.
Really?
Yes.
Central.
Yeah. I remember being very excited that I got to live in this beautiful
Which
room.
One did you live in?
Davies Hall.
Davies. Which one was that?
Yeah, it was a
This was at Ellensburg.
In Ellensburg. I'm pretty sure.
And we did
kind
four
of
them.
A cluster of brick.
We did Meissner, Beck Hall, so on. Then they added two more. That was
that must
one.
Have been one of them. It was right
Davies
by Meissner.
Probably.
I know that it was your hand. It's
the only buildings I ever did which are known by the occupants is the Bassetti dorms. I was on an airplane once with a young woman, and I asked her where she was from, and so on. Told me Ellensburg. And, oh, really? At the college? Yeah. University? Well, where do you stay? She said, well, I live in the Bassettis. And I said, well, really? Do you know what that means? She said, no, I just call them the Bassettis. I don't know why. Anyway.
When Victor was in England, you were pretty much his lieutenant back here for a lot of things.
Elizabeth and Julie and I, and one or two others. Bob Ashley was active, I think, although he was later in the Friends of the Market. I mean, in, what was it called? There was another group trying to save
the Alliance to Save America.
Anyway, we were the ones who kind of carried it on, you know. I hope to say a few words tonight about Vic and our activities.
Were there any repercussions for you professionally from your activity with the Friends on behalf of the market?
Yes, there were. Phyllis Lamphere was dead set against the Friends. Mm-hmm. She wanted to have this new urban renewal project there, which would have put a 34-story building on the site of the Triangle. Slick concrete building. And my ex-partner Jack Morris and Paul Kirk were the designers for that group. And, you know, there were some hard feelings between them and ourselves. They had this big commission, and I can't blame them for wanting to see it go. Mm-hmm. And we were dead set on saving the area. So there were some bad feelings, sort of, between us. But that passed. But Phyllis, I remember, was really strongly for that new development. And she got mad at Vic and me, particularly. I remember Marge Redmond, who was a close pal of Phyllis's, who took me to task once. She just took me by the lapel once and said, what are you doing this for? You know, you're stopping progress. Mm-hmm. Which I shouldn't speak that way. She's dead and gone now. Very bright woman, but I don't know, they got somehow involved in that development. And anything for the market. Well, it would have taken out half the market.
Yeah.
Taken all the sanitary market out, that whole business. Mm-hmm. And down to the triangle where you're standing.
And filled it with towers.
Yeah,
not only taken away that space, but...
Well, they said they would save the core.
Mm-hmm.
But the core without the surrounding would have been isolated and not worth it.
It's pretty remarkable.
So we're lucky.
Thanks to people like you.
Well,
we're lucky.
That we all like.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bassetti.
No, it's not good.
Because he'll be on the target with Chris. I'm thoroughly impressed that this many people remember 25 years ago and where the campaign to start the market, to save the market began. And we're also, I am also pretty well knocked off the beat that there are so many people here who recognize what happened and are impressed enough with the market and the spirit of the market to be here on their own without having the emotional tug of passing petitions. And what am I going to do now? I've welcomed everybody, and that's what the program says: welcome everyone. Shirley.
Old friends and new friends of the market.
Oh, old friends and new friends.
We're here.
God save her, everyone.
I'd like to introduce Jackson Schmidt, who's one of the co-chairs of the campaign to save the market, who is going to explain how you fit into the mix for the next several years.
Thank you.
All right. Yes, I'm Jackson Schmidt. I am the co-president of the Market Foundation. Here's the other co-president, Pat Stusser, and on behalf of the board, Pat and I would like to thank you all for being here. As you can imagine.
There's the secretary and treasurer.
But does he write a check?
That's right.
Yeah, right.
He's enforcement.
As you can imagine, we get to, we've been to a lot of these hosting parties in the last year and a half, 2 years, and clearly I've never seen so many faces and I've never seen so many people I don't know. But it's wonderful it turned out, and that's also a testimony to Shirley now, who have gone well above and beyond the call of duty for having this many people, and I think we should thank them again. Before I leave the thank yous, I must thank Anthony's Home Port, Grand Central Bakery, and the Japanese Gourmet. They have donated all of the refreshments this
evening.
I wanted to take a few minutes and talk a little bit about what the Market Foundation has been doing. As you know, and one of the things that we're doing here today is this is being billed as the 25th anniversary celebration. 25 years ago, certain cities, and it's hard to believe that this could possibly have been the case, but there was actually a proposal, it was called Urban Renewal, to come in and take the market that we know, dig a big hole, put in underground parking, and stick a hotel and convention center on top of it. A group of very committed Seattle citizens got together, decided to do something about it, they got the signatures, they convinced the voters of the city of Seattle to save the market, and today it's preserved as a historic district. It's the wonderful, vital, lively place that we know. In celebration of that event here in 1996, the Market Foundation started planning last September. We had our kickoff back on May 16th down at Steinbrook Park. The mayor came and gave a speech. There was a bicycle race. Peter Steinbrook spoke, and we used it as the occasion of the Starbucks Corporation. We announced their gift of $200,000 to the Market Foundation Capital Campaign, the largest single gift that the Market Foundation has ever received. What a great way to kick off the 25th celebration. There are many more events coming this summer you should be aware of. August 16th is going to be a big day. It's the market-to-market Bring Your Pig event. I'm sure you all have a pig, right? What's happened is we the Market Foundation has had manufactured hundreds of replicas of Rachel the Pig. They're being distributed throughout the town. You'll see them in every U.S. Bank branch. We're asking families, children, retailers to fill them up with coins, bring them down to the market. There's going to be a contest and prizes for who can bring in the most spare change. Also that evening, there's going to be a fund event. We're closing off the market, fencing it off, putting in what we hope is going to be the world's largest picnic table from one end to the other. We're getting the best restaurants in Seattle to serve the food. Starbucks is hiring live music. We're getting blues bands. We don't know who yet, but they're coming. And it's just going to be a tremendous evening. It's a sunset dinner in the park in the market, and we hope that it's going to be an annual and continuing tradition in the market. It's the night of Friday, August 16th, right after you bring your pig.
Yeah, right.
To the market. What else is going on? We've opened a store in the market. If you all know where Flower Lane is, right there in the center. The Market Foundation is now selling goods, the proceeds of which go into the Market Foundation Fund. The raffle covers. In September, we're having a series of lectures, four Sundays in a row, speakers and topics all relating to the history of the market. And next week, we complete the installation of the historical exhibits in the market. It's a new thing, and they're getting rave reviews. So next time you're down there, make a point of going and seeking them out. And they tell the story of the market, and they also tell the story of the friends of the market, people who 25 years ago did what they did so that we could be here today. The reason that the Market Foundation is doing these events and celebrating this is twofold. One, it's our charter to preserve the character and the spirit of the Pike Place Market. And we think in order to do that, it's important to educate the people who use the market so that they understand that the market is really, it's truly a community. I think it's much more like a medieval village than an open-air Northgate Mall, which many people are under the mistaken impression it is. Secondly, it's an opportunity for fundraising, which is what we do to provide the funding for the market agencies, and Bill will talk more about that in a few minutes. So that's kind of the agenda of what we're doing this summer. Before I turn it over to Bill, there's a special group of people we've invited here tonight, and I'd like to take a minute to recognize them. Back in 1990, the market faced another threat that began with the word urban. This time, it wasn't urban renewal. It was the urban economy. It was a group of investors who had entered into some transactions back in the 1970s, perfectly legitimate tax transactions, who, when the rules changed in flagrant bad faith, claimed that they owned the market. So three entities and organizations rushed to the defense of the market. The city of Seattle stepped in. The Pike Market PDA, headed by Shelley Yap at the time, and Shelley is here this evening, and she's still
to my left.
There she is. Shelley is still in charge of the PDA. Peter Steinbrook formed the Citizens Alliance, and they stepped into the fray. The two of them gathered an entire crew of attorneys and others, many of whom are here this evening, to step in. And I was thinking today, I remember early on in that process, I knew we were going to win that case. It was clear to me we were going to win it, and it was obvious why. After a series of meetings I sat through with Shelley and with Peter, I was convinced that these are two of the strongest-willed people who have ever walked the face of the earth.
It's true.
No one could withstand those two people. Indeed, in short order, about a year and a half, they threw many of us at the problem, and the problem went away. It was solved successfully. It's only been since that experience, and since I became involved with the market board, that I think I really truly understood what it was we were preserving and what it was we were protecting. The market has over 500 residents down there, average age over 64 years old, average annual income less than $6,000. What allows them to live there, what allows the market character and spirit to be maintained is the agencies that the Market Foundation funds. The Pike Market Medical Center sees 24,000 patients a year. absolutely booked full time. The senior center, I was up there the other day, it was absolutely overcrowded, packed with people. They serve 20,000 lunches a year. They've got an old three-burner stove that they crank them out on. The daycare center, 170 families are served by that on an annual basis, over 60% of them on scholarships, money provided by the Market Foundation. The food bank. Food bank distributes over 1,000 bags of groceries a week, and many of those are delivered to people who are housebound, elderly, who can't get out and get their own groceries delivered. I think the mission of the Market Foundation and those agencies is at the very heart of what the market's about and what was being preserved. And on behalf of the Market Foundation, all of you here who were involved in that litigation, we want to thank you because that's what you're saying. Thank you very much. Bill True is now going to talk with you about the capital campaign.
I'm quicker, but you have to kind of go through this part of it too. I really have.
Bye.
You're leaving? I have kind of two roles tonight. The first one is I kind of want to be the tote board. And the tote board is, there's two numbers I'd like to share with you. The first one is the capital campaign for the Market Foundation is at 2.55.
Yes.
We have $3 million goal.
Very good.
We're very much at the tail end, but we need your help. We need lots more help in this last year, the 25th anniversary year. We're really looking at this year as the time for us to finish the campaign and raise the money we have to raise to do all the things that Jackson talked about in terms of the agencies and the market in general. The second number, which in some ways for hoofprint parties, as Jackson talked about, we've been doing a lot of these over the last 3 years, is that this group raised $10,000 before it even started. So that all the people who RSVP'd know raised $10,000. So
that's right.
So I'd really like to offer that as a challenge to this group in terms of our ability to raise some money tonight. Because the other role, the other hat I have tonight, is I'm a pitch man. I'm really am here to ask for money. And there's just no two ways about it. We're looking to raise those remaining approximately $500,000 for the market. Let me tell you a little bit about the campaign and the kinds of things we funded and we've committed to fund into the future. So far, we have committed, one of the really fun things about the project and the campaign is that we are doing lots of small projects. And so we've gotten to see a lot of the projects already come to fruition. The windows at the corner market, the refrigeration at the food bank, the public seating that's now throughout the market that's been so sorely needed for so long. All these things are because of the Care for the Market campaign. And the big one that we point to in our it's kind of the fun one, is the expansion of the play space at the Child Care Center. All projects that really happened only because the Market Foundation capital campaign that we're talking about tonight. So we're very pleased about that. We're very much on the home stretch. We're trying to raise the last $500,000, which would go to what we call the Market Fund. The Market Fund is a fund that the Board of Directors started several years ago to fund special projects, the kind of projects that all of you know a lot more about than I do in terms of the history of the market's commitment to low-income and elderly people. The Market Fund has funded the retention of low-income housing at the Gatewood Hotel. It will help the retention of low-income housing at the Elliott Hotel. It has also been the seed money for the Resident Advocate. If you don't know about that program, it's a terrific program where there are someone looking out for the low-income and elderly residents within the market, and that came from the Market Foundation. So we're very excited about the campaign. We're very excited about the campaign wrapping up. We want your help. We need your help. Please help. The pledge cards are here, and they'll be distributed. I've done this so much that I used to kind of be timid at this part of it.
No, you're very good.
please help. Before we do that, what I'd like to do is, and I also, those of you, I'd like to point out that the, it's already happening. That's great. there's all sorts of really fun ways to recognize your gift. And the most obvious one, I hope you've seen all the hoof prints that are kind of squiggling their way from Rachel out to First Avenue. If you haven't, I hope you do. And that would be a $1,000 gift, which is why we call these footprint parties. So we hope to help out. With that, I'd like to introduce a few people who've been nice enough to prepare some kind of thoughts and the remembrances of the market. And is Fred here?
Yes, he's over there by the...
Could you start off?
A different friend.
That's right. Go ahead.
I'd like to read a couple of things about the early days relating to the market getting started. I mean, the fight to save the market getting started. One specifically about Victor and one about our feeling for the character of the market. Before I do that, though, I want to say that when I was about 6 years old, my mother used to, we lived out of Boston, which is about 10 miles south of Seattle, and now part of Tacoma. My mother would bring me in, about 1924 or something like that, on the interurban. And we'd go down to Mortimer, walk down to Mortimer Junction, and walk, and then we'd come in on the interurban, which stopped on Occidental, where it hit here's the Smith Tower right here, here's Yesen. Occidental comes in there, and that's where the interurban stopped. And we would get on the streetcar, go up 2nd or 3rd or 1st Avenue to the market. And she would do her shopping about once a week, and leave me as about a six-year-old or so with my face up against the window of the taffy-making machine. There was a machine that did something like this and made taffy. And if that didn't bored me, and I'd go over to the donut-making machine. Somehow, I don't know, I suppose it's like making smoke rings. And made dough rings and then dumped them in the boiling pot. And when she was done with her shopping, she would always find me there. And we'd go back down to the river. At any rate, years later, Vic told me once that when we were doing the campaign, he said I had introduced him to the market. Now, I don't remember that at all, and I'm kind of proud of that happened because but at any rate, I'll read first the statement on the market that was made about 25 years ago. This is how we felt about it. There was a group of us, architects, lawyers, our engineers, Don Frothingham, I remember, Bob Ashley, I remember. We would go to the Bolivian restaurant. I can't remember the name of the guy. Who started the Copacabana. Well, it was called the Copacabana.
That's not bad.
Anyway, but there were about six or eight of us that would go there for lunch, and there were only seven or eight seats. So we would have to sit outside, and he would set down a produce box and put this paper over. There. That was the Cracker Barrel Club. That was before the Friends of the Market started. Then finally we got when the threat of the city and their big concrete development came that was going to put a 34-story tower, where's the video camera guy, right where he lives on the, Market. That's where this 34-story hotel was going to be. Anyways, we said at that time about the market, it reveals the face of truth. Its roughness reminds me of Seattle's beginnings, its lust for bodies, the vitality that gave it national notice long ago. It's an honest place in a phony time. This was 1970 about. Well, the advertising public relations syndrome aims. The market is a haven where real values survive, where directness can be experienced, where young people who have never known anything other than pre-cut meat, frozen vegetables, or homogenized milk can discover some things that they don't see on television or in Disney's picture books and movies. They will discover that milk is really made up of two parts, skim and cream, that tenderloin steaks are the least part of the steer, carrots are more green than orange. They will learn that food can be preserved even without freezing machines. That such native preserving methods as smoking, pickling, or salting bear the additional gift of heightened flavor. They will also find out that most people are not well dressed and others are not clean. This will do them good. The Pike Place Market is worth holding on to because it is unique in our area. All these things still apply. And yet it does need help. It needs the hammer and paintbrush, not the black wall of destruction. Sympathy and imagination will be worth more here than dollars. The market also needs the revitalizing influence of new customers, people who live nearby and will not add automobile traffic.
Maybe it was our 2 years. Do you remember? 1 year? Anyway, then Julie Anderson and Elizabeth Tanner and I and others kept the thing going. But it was an organism without a heart, without Victor. And this is what I wrote for Victor. There was a going away party, and I read this to him as he left. And how many? I would be interested in seeing. Hold up your hand if you knew Victor personally. How many? Well, a few. Terrific. Anyway, to Victor. There is a man, one who can be counted on. It is not enough to give money or say nice things or think happy thoughts, hoping for the best. One must act, step forward. Vic does, and always did. He's a strong, solemn-looking man, not gaunt and nervous like some I know too well. Yes, a solid man to be depended on. He counts in his city, though some don't like him. Their hangers-on are yes men. He shakes them. He shakes them with his faith in people. They like a steady boat tied to land. He does count, and his strength grows each year. But most people like him, the ones that matter with me, the real ones, because he's right. He doesn't play it safe. He goes where civic trouble is and takes his stand. He disarms the enemy with a smile and a 10-foot pen. Seattle's loss is London's gain, but they won't go to until it's too late, and he'll be back here by then. To Victor and his family, bon voyage and au revoirci, 1967. Come on, I have that beer.
Things I'm going to share that I was proud of, and when I kind of came between years, and I would like the record to show that the market was not sold on my watch. Regardless of Jackson's history, it was not sold until I tried out my DVD. The other one, though, was the early recognition that services to people who live in and around the market.
Locked in by the magic.
Now the fight about the renovation song was what, late '60s, wasn't it? I remember that. I don't remember it very well.
How to renovate it and things like that.
Yeah, but which was defeated. You know that initiative that he talked about.
Oh, great! Right. Okay, that's what.
Late '60s or early '70s.
It was 1971.
So that was 71.
Yeah. What had happened all through the '60s was various plans. Approved or signed off by the city government.
Because it was in bad shape.
It was in bad shape. And the money was available from the federal government. So they kind of wanted to cash in on that. And that went on. then the friends said, look, at the market is pretty nice the way it is. We'd like you to keep it. Kind
yeah,
of like
that's
that.
What I remember.
Yeah.
Yeah. It looked the same.
Yeah. What were you doing then in 68, 69 or so?
Well, in 68, 69, I was finishing a master's degree at the University of Washington. I mean, I was going back to school as an old student. And mm-hmm. I ran for the legislature in 72. So so that was before I was politically involved.
Did you have any, did you sign the petition or did you know people
yes,
who were active in that?
Yes, I remember going to the market, visiting the market, and what I particularly remember is that after it was all renovated, it looked the same.
Uh-huh.
That's what I remember.
Yeah, that was exactly
that's what
thing,
I most
yeah.
remember. And that was, I think, what was most charming, that people, that's what they wanted. They wanted it to feel the same.
Mm-hmm.
To feel the same.
Yeah, yeah. Were you a native of Seattle?
Oh, no.
Of this region?
No, no.
You came from?
Well, I came from New Jersey originally, but I hadn't lived in New Jersey. I really came from living in Caracas, Venezuela.
Hmm. Okay.
So that was a long time ago.
This is a question I ask everybody. What was your first impressions of the market that made you realize it was special?
I think it's complexity.
Mm-hmm.
And the many layers and levels, and I mean both words.
Yeah.
And then that wonderful display of everything. And the type of people.
Mm-hmm.
All of those things were different from Ghirardelli Square, for example, in San Francisco. Just worlds apart.
Yeah.
Worlds apart. One was artificial, Hollywood type, and one was very real feeling.
Mm-hmm. Good. Did you had, were beyond the 71 initiative, but you were in the legislature, and you were important in saving the market the second time from the New York investors with the state's...
Helped get a little bit of money. A little bit of money for the local market.
Over $1.5 million, wasn't it? Yeah. And, that's a second history, you know. That.
Yeah, that's another chapter.
Yeah.
That was another chapter. And that was a pretty disturbing chapter, how that worked out.
Well... about it.